الحمد لله، الحمد لله رب العالمين، الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه وعلى بيته ومن اتبع سنته أجمعين. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قال الله تبارك وتعالى: وأنفقوا مما رزقناكم من قبل أن يأتي أحدكم الموت فيقول ربي لولا أخرتني إلى أجل قريب فأصدق وأكن من الصالحين ولن يؤخر الله نفسا إذا جاء أجلها والله خبير بما تعملون. صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم والعاقبة للمتقين ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I recited the verse from Surah Al-Munafiqun, verse number 10 and 11. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and spend in charity of that with which we have provided you before death comes to one of you. And he says, my Lord, if only you gave me as respite for a little while, that is returned to the worldly life, then I shall give sadaqah, which is that is zakat and all form of charity of my wealth, and be among the righteous, that is those who perform the hajj and other good deeds. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and Allah grants respite to none when his appointed time of death comes, and Allah is all aware of what you do. So with this ayah, we understand there are two aspects of it, that Allah is first is commanding, spend from the sustenance we have given to you before one of you comes to his time of his death. And then he will ask Allah. This is the conversation which one would wish those who are at the deathbed on their end of the life. They are saying, my Lord, give me a moment, because when situation changes, the feelings changes and the perception change and the reality change. With the time and situation, if I'm in a position where I know this is my last moment of my life, and if I'm seeing the angels coming and taking my body and soul, separating, at that moment, all what I have with the wealth and possession and whatever value, it will mean nothing, because all of this is going to be left behind. As Islam teaches us, as Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, a person possesses three things, two of them left behind, and one of them comes to his grave with him. One is the one which he possesses, the wealth will be left behind as he dies. The second close one for him is the family and loved ones. They will bring him to the grave, it stopped there. The third thing which will come with the person to the grave is his amal, his deeds. So we should be mindful of that. These are the moment where we should understand this blessed month of Ramadan and the masjid we are sitting in today at this very moment. We know that there are certain spending and places to spend is required. So one thing understood from this is, if a person who is already gone dead, if he has already died and he will wish or she will wish to come back to the worldly life, for the life for which world we are fighting and we are struggling every single moment to possess more and more, it is never enough. As we can see, and we can see, reflect on our own life, we don't need to see outside, that when we were born, we were naked and without any wealth and possession. But Allah has provided us with the rizq of mother, who provided food to us, and the love of father, who provided protection for us. And as we grew older, they keep lovingly growing us. They were spending their best of effort to provide us, and same we are doing for our new coming generation of the children. Yet, none of them will come with us in our grave. And again, what we are doing to them, Islam teaches us, if we take care of our children and our wife and our family and our loved ones and our family, our community, and anything what we do, even a smile is a sadaqah. When we provide our family is a sadaqah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that you should send forth these good deeds. One of the spending is that what we have in the wealth collected. What wealth we have, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that if you have a chance to come back to life, every single one of the soul will wish that I would spend everything what I have in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which means this money is not going to go with us. And we'll be still accountable if we left behind without the proper training and teaching and upbringing of our children. So whatever they will spend, they will, if they spend good or they spend in the bad way, whichever way they spend, we'll be accountable. So once Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam came home, Aisha al-Mumin radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, ya Rasulullah, we had a goat we slaughtered. Do you like the upper limb of the animal? And we saved it. The rest of it, we gave it to sadaqah. He said, no, the saved one is the one which you gave out. The what you preserve is going to be consumed and used by us. So this is Islam's teaching. وَلَنْ يُخْرَ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِذَا جَاءَ عَجَلُهَا. Then there is no respite for a person when the time of death comes. Everybody has to leave. And we all are to be accountable for our earning and our deeds, what we have earned in the worldly life. When we pay zakat or we pay sadaqah, there is a beautiful interpretation. First of all, we should know, as I talked about it past, that there's a sadaqah wajibah and sadaqah nafilah. So wajibah is the obligatory which we pay zakat once a year. For a person who is Muslim, adult, and have the wealth. Muslim, adult, wealth, and health means he's adult and mentally capable. So if that person have more than a certain amount of value, worth the wealth, he has, she has to give once a year. If it is in his or her possession for a year. If that possession is lost a day before his final date of the year, he does not or she does not require to pay. So there is something to understand. What is this Allah is asking for? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking for something, for example. A scholar give this beautiful example to make us understand and comprehend. If we buy a watermelon, or if we buy a banana, any fruit, mango, what do? We peel off the skin. We know this much thickness in the, at least watermelon. We know that the thickness of at least this much for the bananas. And so as little thinner, but it's still the skin of the mango. So any fruit we eat, we don't eat the skin, which is not edible. But when we peel the skin, we never think that we are losing any money or any food, because we know that portion is not edible. And that is the portion we gave away. It is about 20% of the fruit. It is about 20% of the fruit. You take the lemon or watermelon fruit out of watermelon, 20% weight gone. You take out the banana, 20% of the skin is peeled, and then you come on the banana. We never think twice that I am losing my money because we buy the animal fruit with the skin. When we slaughter animal and we take out the skin of the animal and the certain part of the animal, we never think that we are wasting anything, but we know that it's supposed to be not edible. So this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, that when you dispose this zakat money, you are letting away this portion, which is 20%, 2.5% of it which we give it. So which is supposed to be a benefit for us. It is going to benefit in the dunya and the akhirah, the zakat and the sadaqah. So there is a zakat which is obligatory and the sadaqah which is also non-obligatory, which we can give any time of the year to anybody we can. Zakat has a certain restriction, as I mentioned when I was here last time, that zakat can be only given to certain people with certain requirement. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَتَيْتُم مِنْ رِبًا لِيَرْبُوا فِي أَمْوَالِ النَّاسِ فَلَا يَرْبُوا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ وَمَا أَتَيْتُم مِنْ زَكَاةٍ تُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْمُضْعِفُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying in the Surah Rum, verse number, chapter 30 and verse number 39, whatever you give to people in interest to earn and grow the interest from them, it will not be growing as an interest with Allah. So interest trading is haram. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in verse saying, do not give interest to, or do not earn the interest by giving money. That is not going to grow with Allah. Allah does not like interest earning. Allah says, whoever does the interest trading, going to declare war against Allah and His Messenger. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَتَيْتُم مِّن زَكَاةٍ. Whatever you give in the zakat, تُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَ اللَّهِ, to seek the countenance of Allah, seeking the face of Allah, means the closeness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُدْعَفُونَ. مُدْعَفُونَ, they are the people who will get the growing and returning of the increment, which will be doubling and quadrupling and multiplying with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said in the hadith we hear every year in Ramadan to reminding us, he said, رَغَمَ أَنْفُ رَجْلٍ ذَكَرْتُ عِنْدَهُ فَلَمْ يُصَلِّ عَلَيَّ. The man before whom I am mentioned, if he is not saying salawat upon me, be humiliated. His nose, رَغَمَ نَفْسْ أَنْفُ is the nose in Arabic. So his nose be dusted, means rub on the dust, means insultingly perished. The one who has my name heard and does not send salawat upon me. So anytime we say Muhammad, everybody should say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Say with me, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So every time we hear Muhammad, we all should say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There is no hesitance. There is a hasanat from it, which we have mentioned before. And then he said, وَرَحْمَ عَنْفٌ رَجْلٍ دَخْلَ عَلَيْهِ رَمْضَانٌ ثُمَّ نَسْلَخَ فَقَلْ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَغْفَرَ لَهُ. The men who have Ramadan entered and left without him getting the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Means Ramadan came and left without him getting the forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he said, وَرَغِمَ أَنْفٌ رَجُلٍ أَدْرَكَ عِنْدُهُ أَبْوَاهُ الْكِبَرَ فَلَمْ يَدْخَلَهُ الْجَنَّةِ. And the one, قَالَ عَبْدُ الرَّحْمَنِ وَأَسْنَهُ قَالَ أَوْ أَحْدَهُمَا. So Abdurrahman says, maybe one or both of the parents he heard from Rabbi alayhi salatu wasalam. If a person found his parents going to elderly age and did not enter the Jannah, means did not please them. The Jannah is under the feet of the mother and also from the pleasure of parents, no matter how righteous and pious we can be. And then Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said about this time of the month, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ فَرَضَ صِيَامٍ in Ramadan. Allah, indeed, Allah had made obligatory the fasting in the month of Ramadan. وَالسُنَّةَ تَقِيَامُ and sunnah as the talawat al-tarawee. فَمَنْ سَامَ وَقَامَ اَحْتَسَابًا خَرَجَ مِنَ الذُّنُوبِ كَيَوْمِ وَلَدَ أُمُّهُ. The one who did fasting and made the Tarawih Salah in the nights of Ramadan and the day of Ramadan fasting, he or she will come out at the Ramadan as if it's a newborn baby from the womb of their mother. Musnad Ahmad, 1660 hadith number. These are the hadith of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. We do believe in it. We do know that the sadaqah, when we give sadaqah, so benefits of sadaqah, what it is. One is that it is one of the door of Jannah. Sadaqah is one of the door of the Jannah. Sadaqah is also most virtuous action in all actions, and the best form of sadaqah is to feed others. Sadaqah will be shared on the day of judgment and it will save person from the fire. Sadaqah make the anger of Allah cool down. It is also cools down the heat in the grave. So it cools the fire of the grave of a person. The best and the most benefit gift for a deceased person is sadaqah, and Allah continues to increase the reward of sadaqah. So if somebody died, our parents, our loved ones, we can give sadaqah on their behalf. Before we die, we can let the sadaqah go for us. As Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, three accounts are open, except everything. One is sadaqatun jariyatun, waladun salihun yadulaha, wa ilmun nafin yanfuhu bih. So this is what Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam have said. Then the sixth point is sadaqah is a way to purify the soul and increase the good deed. And another seventh point is sadaqah will be a cause of happiness on the day of judgment on the face of the sadaqah giving person. Sadaqah eighth point is a source of peace from the danger of a day of judgment, and it does not let you grieve the past. Next point is that sadaqah is a mean of sin being forgiven and also expiate past sin. So we can wash our sin by giving money. This is the waste part which we have the fruit. This is the skin of the fruit which we eat, like a watermelon and the banana. 10th point is sadaqah is a glad tiding for a good death and is also cause for the dua of the angels. So when we give sadaqah, angels give us the dua. And it is promised that it will make the death a person of in the faith. And this also, the person, 11th point is, who gives sadaqah is from the best of the people, and all those associated with it will also receive the reward. So we give sadaqah, our parents get the benefit because they raise us well. If we give it in their name, we still get the reward, and our children will get the benefit that abuhuma kana salih. So in Surah Al-Kahf, so the parents are righteous, the children get the benefit of it. Then person who spend in the is counted in those who have piety, and people who also begin to love him. You know, people always love and respect those people who are giving sadaqah. And giving sadaqah is a sign of kindness and grace. Sadaqah is a mean of dua being accepted and hardship being removed. Sadaqah removes difficulties and closes 70 doors of haram in the world. Sadaqah is a mean of aid and well-being. It means it gives a person longer life and better health. And what is it? When you have sickness, give sadaqah. Allah Ta'ala will relieve the illness from that. Also increases the mean of success and provision, increase the risk of that person. Nobody gets get poor from giving sadaqah. Sadaqah is a cure and it's a medicine. This is what I just mentioned. Sadaqah prevents theft and bad death and burnt from fire and drowning. Sadaqah is rewarded even if it is on animal and bird. In other words, when we feed the animal and birds, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts it. So we have mentioned that the eight kind of people we can give sadaqah, which I mentioned, which is a zakat which is coming now. Sadaqah is for the faqir, with the miskeen, and those who are managing it, and the people who have recently embraced Islam, or those who are in a powerful position, with Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to give the money to protect the Muslim, the politician and the leaders. And then the gharimeen, those who have been in the dead, the Muslim who are in debt. Wafirriqab, and those who have been in the bondage and slavery in the prison, or somebody has a fine to be paid on this behalf. Ibn Sabil, Sabilillah. There are eight people, they have restrictions. Sabilillah is a big wide category, but our Hanaf ulama says that you cannot give zakat money unless you make a person owner of it. You have to make the person owner of it. And you can give it, and that person, once he gets it or returns back to you, is going to be not any more sadaqah or zakat. It's going to be a clean money. If a maid came to Prophet ﷺ and it was from the zakat, so a woman came in and she asked, Ya Rasulullah, give me something. He gave her the meat. She took home and cooked it and brought it back to Rasulullah. So the wife of Rasulullah said, Ya Rasulullah, this was a zakat food. We are not entitled. He said, zakat was for her. For at is a hadiyah, it's a gift. So we can now take it. Once the exchange happened, it's no more zakat. It's become the property of the owner. And this is why ulama of Ahnaf, and particularly Ahnaf, they are the Hanafi school, they are very strict about giving the person, making the owner of the property. Exchanging the value of the thing, once it changed the hand, it becomes the property of someone. So now, we have sadaqah, which we can give it to upline, to usul. Well, for usul means the parents and grandparents, they cannot get the zakat. Children and grandchildren cannot get the zakat. Brothers, sisters, friends, community, other people can get the zakat. So there is certain lot of things in the details about it, but zakat is obligatory upon few items. One is gold, number two is silver. If you have a gold equal to 20 dinar, which is equal to 7.5, dinar is equal to 8.748 of the value of the gold in the grams, which is divided by 40. So that is what the value you need to take. If you have a gold, we have to calculate the amount, the wealth of it, and the grams of it, and then divide by 40, and that's the becomes the 2.5%. Silver is same, 200 dirham. This is the currency of time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, which is around 11.66 gram. So 5 dirham, if a person possesses of silver, which has come to 612 gram point 36 divided by 40, and that is what we need to give for the silver. And the wealth, cash, the bonds, the stocks, and the whichever cashable money, we have to add it up and divide it by 40. And that was the amount we need to give out in zakat. The four things we need to give is the livestock, which we don't have. But if you have a livestock for the goat, for a person who has 40 goats, you have to give it one baby goat. If he has 80 goats, then he has to give two of them. This is how it goes. The cow, a person has 5 cows, he has to give one goat for that. And then if you have 10 cows, there's a certain amount goes to the up to 30 cows, they have to pay only one goat. And we don't have it. But these cows, according to the scholars, are to be grazing in the natural ground. But you provide them with the feeding, then you don't pay zakat on those animals. If you have a camel, 5 camels, if a person possesses, then he has to give one goat on that. So this is how the calculation for this goes, and then it multiplies further on the amount of possession of the person. And then if we have a business, there is no zakat on the property in the home, an usable item, your car, your home, even if your business property, you have a house you have rented, not on the house, but on the income of the house, you will be paying that, minus first the debt on it. If you have a business, you have a store, a food store, or anything, you don't pay the tax on the industry. You pay tax on the inventory and the income, which will become a cash value on you. After dividing, after separating or deducting the expenses on your amount. Honey also is something in which, if you have a so much amount of money, if you have a 10 mashkiza, you know, the one which used to, in old days they used to preserve, one have to be given out of 10, you know, animal hide you fill, out of 10 hide, one have to be given as a zakat. So this is how, and also 10, 20%, the highest amount of zakat to be given on the natural, like oil and gold and minerals, or the phenols or the kans which we get from the earth, those minerals, they have to pay 20%. That's the highest, this is called khums, which is fifth of it. So this is to be paid. Now we are here in our masjid today, and we know that we have expenses of this masjid. And this masjid has been obviously used by only Muslims, alhamdulillah. And us and our children and our those who have our loved ones who have passed away, as we know, few of the recently loved ones have passed away among Dr. Abdul Qayyum. We know that he was one of the generous founding member and the donor. I have been given this expense sheet here. It says the electric cost of this masjid is 5,600 of a year. And this is used to be usually sponsored by people in this masjid community. The second thing is water, which is $800 for the year. And this has been sponsored by one of the community members. Internet costs $1,450. It is also being used by our community and for the teaching. As we know, we are doing since the COVID, everything has been done on Zoom and internet is needed for that. Insurance of this property is $6,100, which is to be paid because everything has to be insured. Because if any one of us falls, or somebody falls on the street, on the, our pavement, that can sue the masjid. So this has to be warranted. Yes, news and displays, $2,400. That's only serve us. And this is our expense, not masjid expense. We are the consumer of this cost. Landscaping to maintain the property is $5,500 for the year. Pest control is $830. Other expenses include $65,000. This is the paper I was provided. And we have sent the announcement. And there's a form given to everybody, brothers and sisters. And you can pledge and fill out the form. This is how we will run this operation. As you already see, the dome is under construction. And we know that the cost of the dome is $25,000, the gentleman who is building it. And also the entrance, front entrance, is the estimate is $23,000 to be given. So brothers and sisters, this is the moment. Make a pledge, make a payment. You have been reminded that we should come with the plan to make the payment. We have a very limited time. I have to stop here. If any brother wants to raise their hand and pledge something at this moment, or you want to do it later. Brother Javed has been struggling, our masjid community and Shura has been struggling, and you are all aware of it. There's no secrets in this masjid. There are no extra expenses. All the Shura is volunteer, and nothing is spent or wasted. As you may have seen in the back door when we first had the masjid, this church was converted. You saw that the back door for the entrance of the sisters was being corrected. And there was a tree over there, and the pavement and the parking lot was fixed. So a lot of things have been done, improvement. It's been enough time that this front was to be improved, and the dome is still under construction, which you should know. And the cost of this thing is to be paid by us. So alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given everybody money. What you can do, what you can do is you can pay the cost of this. Again, Alvi sahab can explain you certain other aspect of the zakat ruling and the sadqa ruling. There's one thing, I think time is short, inshallah, some next time I would like to elaborate. Once we want to give zakat, suppose I want to give money, I have enough money to give zakat because I have money for zakat, but my son need money, my parents need money, I cannot give them zakat. So there is something called milk. You need to make somebody valuable. In Sharia Islam, which I've understood in the Hanafi school, you need to transfer the wealth. You have to have the wealth for 1 year. If you do not have 1 year wealth in your possession, you cannot give. So you can convert zakat into sadqah, so it is much more broader application, which you can then give. So what Imam Abu Yusuf used to do, the student of Abu Hanifa, he would transfer his wealth to his wife. He was a chief justice, very wealthy man, gave enormous sadqah, but did not pay zakat. Why? He transferred zakat into sadqah by giving it to his wife. 6 months later, she will return it to him. So that will become sadqah, and he would give all the money which he has to give in the sadqah as a zakat money into sadqah, which is much more wider application. This is one of the things which some people do not comprehend. So if you have any further explanation required, Imam Alvi can explain you how this works and how this can be done. So right this very moment, I would like to know if any brother would like to contribute or raise hand or some pledge here. Subhanallah, Takbir. Brother Ismail, Yusuf Ismail have donated $1,000. Takbir.
Sheikh,
brother, mashallah, Takbir. So we have brother who is giving it this donation, mashallah. May Allah accept from us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from these brother.
Assalamualaikum, brother. Daughter, Salwa, mashallah, always every month doing, you know, he donated $500 today also. And inshallah, I will, from Chaudhary family, I will donate $5,000.
Mashallah, Takbir. Takbir. Inshallah, I'll pledge more money, but I don't want to disclose the amount. Inshallah, I will give my more share of the masjid community. So any brother, anybody else wants to do any contribution before we begin the Jummah? Time is very limited.
If not, we have a form. You can, you know, just raise the hand and we have a form. We can give it to you and you can commit, you know, just
I have one suggestion, if I may propose.
Yes, sir.
That please take the pledge form